Welcome back to Taking the Leap podcast. I'm your host, Bob Dickey. And this morning we have two guests in our studio, two guests that you have heard in the past. For those listeners who have been listening to the podcast for a while, we've got Jim Martin from Cape Coral, Florida. And we have got Joe Darkangelo from Milford, Michigan. Two really close friends of mine and fan favorites here for listeners on the podcast. And entrepreneurs who weathered the COVID crisis in two very different locations. Both Florida and Michigan were all over the news. Both states had completely different, I guess, practices in terms of how the governors and local politicians were handling the COVID crisis. And I've been in both states with you guys here recently, and Florida's wide open for business. And we've got people from New York that are moving down. I've got a bunch of my friends that had homes and residences in New York City, and they're like, okay, I'm out. I'm going to Miami. I'm going to Palm Beach. Folks from Michigan that I know that are said, I'm out. I need to move down, fun in the sun, heading south. And I've also been back in Michigan to see friends and family. As a Michigan boy, I grew up in the Flint area, went to high school there. And so I've got a lot of connections back in Flint. So I'm just kind of curious. I want to chat with you guys both. Thank you for being here in the studio this morning. And I want to get a little bit of your insight on what's going on in our economy, what you guys experienced over the last year, how you managed through with your teams, with your business. And some of the things that you did. So, first of all, Jim, welcome.
Hey, thanks, Bob. It's good to be here in Knoxville with you in the office instead of doing it over the phone and stuff. But it's interesting to see because we do have a lot of business up in Michigan and a lot in Florida. Mm-hmm. And to watch Florida be wide open, our governor likes freedom. Mm-hmm. And he wanted the entrepreneurs that own small businesses to be open for business. And, you know, we were locked down for, I think, 6 weeks total, really, that, mm-hmm. that was very enforced. After that, he's like, this is ridiculous. He recently came out, signed executive orders that he's not going to enforce any COVID-mandated laws, like wearing masks or any of that stuff like that, because he supports science, mm-hmm. right? But so in that regards, our business, our state that's been open has been great, but at the same time, there's a media that still scares a lot of people. Mm-hmm. And honestly, we canceled all of our TV, right? Like, we just aren't TV watchers, but it seemed like everything just had to do with how bad everything was. In reality, it's not that bad, right? We do have a lot of business in Michigan. Those folks are still deathly afraid. Mm-hmm. It seems like a lot of them are anyways. How we weathered it is we went a lot of virtual stuff. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that worked good. It wasn't perfect, but it kept our business going. Honestly, because of what we do, our business sped up in some spots of the mm-hmm. country and yep. slowed down in other spots, just for the fear factor right. of the unknown. You know, it was a political year, COVID hit, all that stuff. But as an entrepreneur, we had to adapt and be flexible. You know, and I've always wanted to be proactive mm-hmm. and keep my business going, sure. right? Because if it's not moving forward, it's going backward. It yep. really never maintains. So we just found other ways to, instead of meeting in person, it was a lot of virtual calls, mm-hmm. A lot of phone calls, a lot of sent videos and audios. Right. But overall, I think we weathered it good and came out stronger for it, because now we understand our business a little bit better in ways that if something arises like this again, we know we can weather it. Mm-hmm. Our business is inflation-proof, and we know inflation is coming big time with everything that's gone on with the government printing money and stuff like that. So I think we weathered it great. The office here in Knoxville has been superb. That's always been moving forward for our business. Mm-hmm. So mentally, I think we're in a great position to continue to grow. It's going to, from the knowledge that we learned in the last year, I think it's going to be good for us to be able to expand it to other countries.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, so overall, I know COVID was a big, big issue for a lot of people, mm-hmm. businesses, states. But if you didn't do If you wanted to change and adapt, you would. Mm-hmm. But so many people that I know that have lost businesses, lost unemployment, they don't want to change. Mm-hmm. And in reality, our world's changing, and if we don't change with it, we're going to be left behind. So yeah. Entrepreneur will always find a way to gut it up, keep going, run for those goals, and overall win.
Right. Well, it seems to me that the entrepreneurial DNA is all about adapting and overcoming. You know, you've got pivoting on a pretty frequent basis, and entrepreneurship is not about living life in some type of stasis where everything's just staying the same, but we're in a constant state of change, a constant state of adaptation, and growing, and especially now. I mean, I think in economies in the past, changes happened maybe at a less rapid pace, and right now change is just abundant all around us, and it's the thing I think most people are maybe discomforted in is the fact that change is so rapid right now that they can't adapt quick enough, right? They just don't know what to do. And so, but you're absolutely right. Entrepreneurship is just like, look, this is when you sign up to be an entrepreneur, when you get in business, you've got to have thick skin and you've got to be like, all right, I'm going to adapt and overcome. So I got to see you firsthand doing that down in Florida. And of course, you've got business all across the country. And it's interesting saying the approach that I think Florida and officials down there had was a little more on the freedom side of, hey, we're going to live and let live. We want to make sure that we're protecting people, but we're going to allow people and business owners to make decisions that's in the best interest of them and the local communities. And Joe, that seems to be a stark contrast from what you experienced up there in Michigan. So living in Milford, Michigan, and as a Michigan boy your entire life, tell me a little bit about what you experienced this last year during this COVID crisis and how you and your family kind of weathered it and how you handled it.
Well, thanks, Bob, first of all, for having us on the Taking a Leap podcast. This is always fun, and your viewership's going through the roof, so that's exciting times for sure. Good job, bud. Hey, Jim was talking about the Florida versus Michigan, and Laura and I, my wife and I, do spend a couple months a year, 2 to 3 months a year in Florida. So this last year we were in there, and there's just a stark difference between the two states, right? So we spend most of our time in Michigan, and I just felt like, it's cloudy in Michigan most of the time anyway, mm-hmm. compared to Florida. But I noticed that people's attitudes were even cloudier. People were hunkered in their homes, depressed, and all these things were happening. And business owners don't like that. I've seen business owners mm-hmm. just in their homes, not knowing what to do. Like Jim said, people just watching TV and getting caught up on all the negative. But a true entrepreneur, man, I'm telling you, gets out and says, listen, there's some things we can control and there's some things we can't. Mm-hmm. And the way we have the attitude to handle this is all the difference in the world. So Michigan, what's cool is Michigan's starting to get it now. People are starting to get out mm-hmm. of their homes. Things are starting to open up a little bit. And then people are feeling better. I think people's overall health is going to be better because of it. And you could just learn from everything they've done in Florida that it's working the way they're doing it down there. But in Michigan right now, entrepreneurs are coming. If you're a true entrepreneur by heart, you'll figure it out and you'll get out of that bunker and say, listen, let's go help as many people as we can.
I remember about halfway through the 2020, and when Michigan was really in the news about businesses that were getting hammered, they were still shut down. People were losing their businesses right and left. And generally speaking, people who have a high media profile tried to stay out of, making comments. And one of the things that I found really interesting was Matt Stafford's wife. So Matt Stafford, the Detroit Lion quarterback, right? Very popular figure there in Michigan. One of the best quarterbacks in the NFL. And his wife has a huge following on Instagram and social media. And generally, she's taking pictures of, her family and her husband and, all that type of stuff. And I was shocked when she was sitting in her car. And I have business friends up in Detroit who know the Staffords pretty well and connected with them. So I know she's got her finger on the pulse of what's going on there in the local economy. And she had a video where she just, basically went off on the officials in Michigan and the governor in Michigan saying, you don't know what your policies are doing. You're hurting businesses. People are losing their jobs. We need to, open up and have a little more freedom here for entrepreneurs to be able to do their thing. It was probably one of the most well thought and articulated points that I had seen from a very kind of public person. And it went viral, and then like within 24 hours, it got pulled down, right? And so I could tell if someone had went to her and be like, "Hey, this is probably not going to play well in the media, and you don't want to put you and your husband in this type of spotlight." But it was interesting to see people like her who had a platform that were speaking out against it. What else did you see? I mean,
well, a lot of people started doing things virtually, and mm-hmm. they thought that was going to be the end all to everything. That mm-hmm. that's the way life is going
to
be.
We'll just live in our homes, and we'll be able to connect virtually, and everything's going to go on fine.
Yeah, well, we all know that the way you dress. I mean, think about it, when you're at home all the time, you're in shorts, maybe in a nice golf shirt, mm-hmm. or you know, it happens everywhere. But when you can dress up and get out and be professional, that you're more productive, right? So people were doing a lot of virtual things. You had to. That's fine. Mm-hmm. I think virtual will still be around, but just getting around, shaking hands, like mm-hmm. us being in the office here today, just shaking people's hands and saying hi and things mm-hmm. like that's truly powerful. So we had to handle it. We had to work with what we had, and that's what virtual was. Mm-hmm. And I think now, as people get back into having meetings at coffee shops, having meetings at restaurants, having a hotel, whatever it is for your business, I think that's going to be everything, and it's going to be very vital to the success of entrepreneurs in the future.
So, Jim, why don't you jump in here and maybe add to that a little bit? I mean, you were talking earlier about the ability of entrepreneurs to pivot and adapt and overcome. And I saw us as a country, we had a national lockdown, and all of a sudden, Zoom meetings took off, virtual meetings took off, businesses were figuring out how to leverage e-commerce more. You had companies trying to figure out, hey, how do we have our employees at home but still run and operate a business in geographically separated locations? And the thing that I saw was that there even universities went and were like, hey, we're going to have all of our students at home, and we're going to go and we're going to have classes online. So the world moved into a virtual setting, and at the same time, people were trying to figure out, oh, how do we have connection? How do we still maintain relationships? And I think, although I want to hear your opinion on this, right? So we pivoted into this virtual environment, virtual relationships. How did you, you used it to build, you continue to build your business and to thrive, but what did you notice in terms of the connection relationships?
They're not as strong, right? Like one of the books I'm reading, again, is Speed of Trust, mm-hmm. By Stephen Covey. And trust is everything in business, right? If somebody doesn't trust you, so that face-to-face, the alternative, it was Zoom, and you were somewhat face-to-face, but it just wasn't the same. Right? Like, I think we're built for community. Mm-hmm. I look at some churches, they just, their whole congregation just are still staying at home mm-hmm. almost. Ours is packed three services, mm-hmm. right? And it's because the leadership that anybody is under is going to, they're going to model the way. And mm-hmm. I look at our business, our community, people want to get back out, right? Mm-hmm. They need that human connection. So what I'm getting at is I'm glad that we were mm-hmm. able to, use Zoom. Hey, that mm-hmm. was great. But nothing's going to beat looking right. somebody face to face, giving them a good firm handshake.
Yep.
And they know that you're somebody worth following, mm-hmm. right? So I think what I'm teaching folks in my business is you need to read like crazy. You need to prepare yourself because the economy is booming right now mm-hmm. and it's going to cycle again, mm-hmm. right? We know that at some point it's going to cycle. So you need to be setting goals and staying looking ahead all the time, mm-hmm. right? As an entrepreneur, I learned my first business that I owned was I was 12. Yeah. I owned a paper route, and I say it's a business, but you have to buy that paper route. You got to pay for all your papers and go collect. And I remember there was days that I didn't want to go collect, right? In Michigan, storming or snowing or whatever.
Snow, yeah.
And knocking on doors, you remember the movie, I Want My $2, Better Off Dead? Well, I was that guy. I was that kid, right? And There was times I'd have to change it up. And mm-hmm. I think back that how did I adapt? Because there was always certain people that I could never collect from.
Mm-hmm.
But they probably worked a different shift, mm-hmm. right? In Michigan, there's three shifts.
Yeah.
So I scheduled it that I would collect on certain days at certain times, right? So like Thursday at 4 o'clock, I remember, and then Saturday before noon.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't want to do that, but if I want to do my paper route to thrive, mm-hmm. I had to adapt. So I took that into my plumbing company that I used to have years ago, but then I also took it into this,
mm-hmm.
you know, into what we do now today. And without changing and adapting, you're going to be left behind because the world's going to change. But you also have to be mentally prepared for it,
mm-hmm.
you know. When people get into business, they think that it's going to be an overnight success, and it's not, right? It's going to take work, and the work starts with us. Mm-hmm. I mean, our biggest enemy and our biggest problem solver is ourselves,
mm-hmm.
right? So we have to not only be able to think for ourselves, because I think that's when it's taught to go to school, get good grades, get a safe, secure job, I meet a lot of people that's all they do. It's right. It's the same thing day in and day out. When it's the same thing day in, day out, come home, watch TV, go to bed, get up, go to work, and they do that 5 and 6 days a week, people get used to that.
Mm-hmm.
But if they start to look at their bank account for their biggest motivation, because where it's at right now, the way that inflation is coming, if you're making the same amount of money and everything's going up, you're going backwards big mm-hmm. time. And yeah. if people don't realize that, they're going to get caught. Right. Yep.
They're going to get caught in a squeeze. That's basically what's happening right now.
Huge. Right. And a little bit of balance on this credit card. No big deal. A little bit of balance on this. Oh, this came up. All these different things that's going to accumulate. And it's like I heard this years ago. How do you go bankrupt? Well, you went bankrupt 5 years ago. So it was super slow. Then all of a sudden it just went very yep. fast.
Mm-hmm.
And preparation is everything. Mm-hmm. Right. So I think being prepared, as I've learned in the last 20 years of being in business for myself, there's three keys to wealth. Long-term vision. Most people's long-term vision today is the next holiday, right?
The next weekend,
right? So they're not long-term vision to me is what is my life going to look like in 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it can't be based on economy today. Everything's going to change. But you have to have a plan. Delay gratification says you have to prepare yourself, right? Like I remember being in the boys or Cub Scouts, right? Cub Scouts, I would think it was third grade, and I'll never forget the motto: be prepared. And I carried that on through my whole life, right? So what are you in third grade? What are you 7, 8, 9 years old or so? I'm 50 years old today, and I remember that: be prepared. So long-term vision, where are you going to be in the next, X amount of years, depending on your age? Delayed gratification, you better learn some stuff, think for yourself, and be prepared. Why? Because the power of compounding is going to work for you or against you. That's the third key to wealth. And I think a lot of people is going to have the power of compounding hammering them within the next few years if they don't change something. We are in the age of the entrepreneur. You need to own something. We hear all about this gig economy, and people are like, what's the gig economy? It's you have to have something else besides a job.
Mm-hmm.
I've been telling people, if technology can replace your job, it's going to.
Amen. Absolutely.
So if you don't own something outside of a job, you're going to get squeezed.
Mm-hmm.
And your long-term vision of your next weekend, you might be sitting at home doing nothing in a cardboard box, mm-hmm. right? So I don't think people's lifestyles are going to stay the same. People are going to thrive. If we get the word out, hey, be in the age of the entrepreneur and be an entrepreneur, yeah, you're going to take some shots. It's mm-hmm. going to be frustrating at times. But what's the alternative?
Yeah.
We can't let things happen to us, because if we let things happen to us, it's a slippery slope of falling into socialism.
Mm-hmm.
And as an entrepreneur, I'm going to fight as hard as I can to not let that happen.
Well, that you've just laid out some brilliant points here. I love this. You know, the three keys to the three keys to wealth? Number one was long-term vision. Number two was delayed gratification. And number three was compounding. Either is going to work for or against you. And yeah, that is absolutely brilliant. And I see in my everyday life, as you were just articulating here a second ago, that so many people are just like, all right, I'm looking forward to my beach trip. I'm looking forward to the weekend, right? So that's not long-term vision. Definitely not having delayed gratification, you know, super excited about, oh, we got the new, you know, electric Hummer that's coming out. We've got this, we've got that, you know, people, it's just like, all right, well, if you can afford it, great. But if you're going to finance that for 7 or 8 years, right, it's just like, there's a better way to invest that capital, right? Especially right now with the way things are going. And then, of course, that leads into the compounding, either working for or against you. So, absolutely brilliant statements there. But, you know, going back to something, I'd like to, for both you and Joe to highlight this. You were talking about the difference in the two states, whether Michigan and Florida, and how they were operating during COVID. And a lot of it goes back to leadership. And you mentioned that as leaders, people follow leaders. And the pace, right? One of my favorite Maxwell quotes is, the speed of the leader is the speed of the team. And leadership matters, no matter what's going on in life, but especially during a crisis, especially during a season of crisis and doubt. You guys are leaders in your business. You're leaders in your community. What was, how did you navigate that? Because I saw both of you lead in a similar way, which was you decided to raise the bar of excellence in your life. You didn't allow this last year of COVID and crisis and uncertainty for you to lower standards and to lower the bar of excellence, but rather, and I've had conversations with you guys, you both of you raised the bar, which is really different from what I saw happen with a lot of people around the country. Why was it so important for you to raise the bar of excellence in your life during a time of crisis?
Yeah, because, well, we worked so hard for our business for the last 18 years, and if we didn't raise the bar, it could have gone away, mm-hmm. right? I've seen businesses that have been in business for years, if not decades.
Mm-hmm. Iconic American companies.
Right, and their leadership, they thought that they could handle it, and mm-hmm. they couldn't, right? So to me, there was no option. You know, I remember days, because I had COVID back in the summer. I was doing 3 and 4 business meetings a day on Zoom, yes, mm-hmm. on Zoom. But while I had COVID, right, mm-hmm. I literally, I won't say crawl, but get to the computer, put a smile, put a shirt on, mm-hmm. and do a meeting, go back to bed.
Mm-hmm.
Did I have to do that? In my mind, yeah, right? Being mm-hmm. an entrepreneur, you got to do things when it's tough, mm-hmm. you know? And what I see today is mainstream America is soft. mm-hmm. We have to get thicker skin. Otherwise, somebody's going to be taking care of you. And it's, mm-hmm. you know, when somebody else takes care of you, it's probably not the way you want to be taken care of.
Yeah.
You know, so to me, there was just no option, mm-hmm. you know, and it wasn't that I had to think about it. I just had to I had to think about what I need to do to move forward,
mm-hmm.
you know, because I see too many people, they think, and then they think, and they think, and it gets analysis paralysis, mm-hmm. you know, and constipation of the brain, mm-hmm. little movement. So when there's little movement, you can't be moving forward.
Yeah.
Right? You can slide down a slippery slope, but to me, I'd rather push uphill. You know, and I think this is the words that we need to get to our youth today.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the next generation that's coming up, these, you know, what they call millennials, and mm-hmm. what's the next generation after that?
Is it Gen Z? Yeah, millennials, and then they think, or...
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not sure. But Gen Z, yeah.
But, you know, I'll say the 18 to, you know, 25-year-olds mm-hmm. that are right now, and they're smart in a way that they're looking for other ways to make money,
mm-hmm.
But they're not tough, you know. And I look at our kids. We have 4 kids that all have always paid for their own stuff, right? Like, so I'll just use our son, James, that's at home now. He's 19. He bought a car at 15, paid cash for it, his own money. Okay. When he got a cell phone, he had to pay for his cell phones, pay for a service. He's always paid for his insurance. And we could have paid for all that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and sometimes when he tells people that, they look at me and I'm like, pretty responsible.
Mm-hmm.
But mainstream America is our parents should take care of our kids. Well, that is taking care of our kids.
That's teaching them to be resilient, to be self-reliant, to be able to take care of himself.
For sure. And all of our kids that have moved out of the house, which is 3 of them, they're all thriving. They all have their own place. They all have their own careers. Some of them have their own businesses. So I think it's a tough love. Like, nothing was ever given to me.
Mm-hmm.
So why would I do something different? Mm-hmm. Right? We have to do what works. And taking responsibility, accepting responsibility for our lives, I think that's what people need to be taught today. Mm-hmm. Not a handout. Maybe a hand up. Yeah, mm-hmm. a hand up of, you know, tough love. So when we moved to Florida, our older kids were up in Michigan, mm-hmm. right? And our oldest son, Michael, wanted me to co-sign mm-hmm. on a car for him because mm-hmm. he just sold his car that was already paid for. And I told him no. And he worked 3 miles away from the house. And he worked he had to be there at 5:30 in the morning. And he had to walk because I wouldn't buy him a car. I wouldn't co-sign. Mm-hmm. And guess what? After 3 months of doing that, he saved enough money to buy a car. You know, so he
probably appreciated it an awful lot.
Oh, he did. He does now, right? Mm-hmm. And now he drives a RT Challenger, beautiful car. Mm-hmm. And I remember Dolores.
Probably paid cash for it.
yeah. And Dolores, I remember like, well, you know, it's going to be tough on him. Like, yep, it is.
Life's tough.
Life's tough. And at 5 o'clock in the morning, this was the winter mm-hmm. in Michigan, snow, sleet, mm-hmm. freezing cold, to walk there. I know once in a while he might have caught a ride, mm-hmm. but most of the time he was walking.
Yeah.
And now he appreciates it more. Mm-hmm. When there's a crisis, he comes to me and mm-hmm. asks for advice, mm-hmm. you know, and I like that. So in the middle of it, didn't like it. Mm-hmm. Today, now that he's just turned 31 years old, he appreciates it.
Probably one of the toughest, resilient 31-year-old men that you'll meet, right?
Yeah.
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 Joe, let me get you into the conversation here. You and I've had a conversation on this recently, and I was asking you about what was it like, because you've been a police officer and a firefighter, and I said, Joe, tell me about leadership in both of those types of cultures and raising the bar of excellence in those cultures, because there are... it strikes me as your life is on the line in both of those environments, firefighter, police officer, and that if there is somebody on your team or in that environment where they are not maintaining a high standard of excellence. Now, we've seen, you know, in the news recently, police officers who have not had a high bar of excellence and what happens, right? When there's a wrong culture or a low bar of excellence and how dangerous and how, you know, devastating that can be. But I asked you, said, you know, this is a culture that probably self-polices itself because lives are on the line. And tell me a little bit about what, you know, your experience in those environments and maintaining a high standard of excellence. But, you know, character, integrity, professionalism, service to the community, and what happens if someone's not maintaining that. And, you know, we said, I asked you, how does that translate over into the business world? Because in business, lives are on the line as well. You have employment. You've got people whose lives count on these jobs. And shouldn't we maintain a high standard of excellence in professionalism in the business community, in the entrepreneurship community, because it's just as important?
For sure. You know, I do remember that conversation. I'm looking at my notes here, actually. I was going to actually write a talk on this. And back for years, I was a reserve police officer in Milford. Mm-hmm. And you didn't get paid or anything. And you went to the police academy. You were partnered up with a full-time police officer. Mm-hmm. And they counted on you. Some of these guys, if you didn't have your stuff together, so to mm-hmm. speak, yeah. they didn't even want you to ride with them. Like, they would come in, and they would actually, if a reserve officer was ready to go and they didn't like you, they would just stink and leave. They would leave and go on the road and
look
leave
at you and be like, no, yeah. I'm not riding with this bum. I'm just, I'd rather be by myself than have this guy in my car who's going to end up being a liability for me. They got to babysit you.
Right? Exactly. That never just so everybody knows.
That didn't happen to you. Yeah, because you're a professional and a man of high character and excellence in all that you do.
I saw it happen, though. Yeah. So these guys are out there. Their lives are on the line. There's right. no doubt about it. Mm-hmm. And so your partner, you have to count on, right? So yeah. in law enforcement, it's like that, especially nowadays. It's just so unbelievable what's happened in law enforcement. But there's no slackers. You can't have a slacker. If something's going down and someone's... being arrested or whatever the case may be, you got to count on your partner. You got to mm-hmm. count on your backup. Same thing with the fire service. I was a volunteer firefighter for 11 years almost. Mm-hmm. And the same thing. So when you go into a fire, you go into a, say a house is burning. I mean, you got four guys, the first four guys are going to be there. Everybody's doing a different job. If the one guy does not get you water, the guy that goes right on the engineer's panel, and if he can't get you water from that 1,000 gallons that it's in that fire truck to the guy that's in the front door getting ready to go in, that guy going in the front door is going to burn. He's going to die. And so you have to count on each other. And what I found out even in the fire service is that you have to depend on other people. But you're with them training. You're with them doing all these different things to make sure that you know who you're with, right? So being a professional in those as a firefighter and a law enforcement, that's if you apply that same thing to business, like we're in business together. You know, we're friends, but we're in business together. I know I can count on you two for anything, right? And I know a lot of other partners that we have out in the business world and different businesses and everything. So if we do the same thing in business, so if you do the same thing in business, count on the people you're doing business with, and that all goes back to personal development. So it goes back to training for law enforcement, goes back to training in the fire service, but here in entrepreneurship, training is being a better you, right? Being people, somebody you want to be around with. Like back in the reserve days, I think I was kind of fun in a police car, you know, but some people maybe weren't, you know, so they want to be around you. So it's a whole relationship and everything. So,
well, you know, it strikes me as I've watched cultures and environments and the maintaining a high standard of excellence in those environments is just as important as it would be for a police force, a firefighting force, in the military. And, you know, as I said, you know, earlier, lives are on the line. Families, you know, livelihoods are on the line. And if you've got an individual who's not carrying their weight, is not dependable, has basically checked out, maybe somebody who's causing drama, you know, sometimes in the past, I think people are like, well, let's figure out how we can work with this individual. I've heard other, you know, CEOs of other companies that had, you know, high performing people on their staff. They're just like, I had to, you know, remove this individual because it was detrimental to the team. They were not maintaining standards of excellence, and it was hurting the entire performance of the team. And so I think it's extremely important for leaders, no matter what profession that you're in, to make it very clear for people what is the standard of excellence that this organization expects, and this is what we all going to measure up to. This is what's required of all of us, and the leader has to lead from the front. A leader cannot expect his or her staff and their people to maintain a standard of excellence that is higher than the leader. Whatever you, whatever standard of excellence you have as a leader, rest assured your people are going to be that or maybe a step or two behind you, right?
Yep.
And so it goes back to how important leadership is, setting that tone, setting that culture, maintaining that high bar of excellence. And then, you know, I think being very dedicated in managing those folks. And if there's someone on your team that's not performing, you owe it to the entire team to either have a conversation with that individual and say, you know what, you need to measure up, or that person's got to get removed. And just too much on the line. And I think that we're probably going to be seeing some more of that, specifically in law enforcement agencies. You're hearing a lot of talk, right, about how do we measure and make sure standards of excellence across the country are maintained at a very, very high level. Because we've seen, you have one bad apple, you have one person who is not doing their job correctly, and it can paint the entire organization a bad light.
And no doubt, you know, another thing I just thought of, Bob, too, is you ever notice a fire truck or fire engine, they're always clean. They're always taken care of. They're always, actually, you and I were driving yesterday, and I saw a couple fire trucks, and it was raining here in Knoxville, Tennessee. And I told Bob, I said, those fire trucks are out on something or just coming back from something, because they just don't take them out in the rain. They just don't go cruising around the speedway, and, you know, that's not what happens. They're, you know, million-dollar trucks. So proud fire departments, from their leadership, mm-hmm. take care of their equipment. I've seen mm-hmm. fire departments that their trucks are dusty inside their bay, you know, mm-hmm. and where they store them. But I've seen other fire departments that they clean them every day.
Mm-hmm.
There's not a speck of dust on them, right? So they're taking care of mm-hmm. the things that's going to save their lives, right? And the same thing in business. If we take care of the people we're in business with, help them, and give them the tools needed for them to be successful, you surround yourself with successful people, you're going to just ultimately become more successful yourself.
Mm-hmm. Well, speaking of our time together here in Knoxville. Yesterday, one of the things that we got to do is we went down to Garland Mountain for a sporting clay competition. And so we took a group of us guys, went down there, and it was for a charity fundraiser for Thrive Coffee, who is a big partner of ours. And we're super proud to support them. And of course, there were companies from all across the Southeast that were there supporting. But it was a great day to just kind of get out in nature. Beautiful spot. And I think it's Northwest Georgia. Probably one of the nicest sporting clay venues I've ever been
to.
For
sure, yeah.
And, you know, we were there from early morning until in the afternoon, a long day of shooting and just having fun. You know, Jim, to your point, it was, you know, guys getting together, being able to talk face-to-face, even though we've been communicating over this last year, Zooms and emails and all kind of stuff, but it was great to be in person. But it was also great as business leaders who, you know, we've had our heads down, just grinding it out, working really hard. And entrepreneurs love that. Entrepreneurs love the grind. Entrepreneurs love their work. And I can be a little bit predisposed to be maybe a workaholic, right? Like, because I just love what I do. And so it's easy for me to just be all in all the time. And it reminded me yesterday how important it is to be able to hit the pause button and have some time away, specifically just to build relationships, to have conversations, to drive, you know, and to do something fun to allow your mind to engage at a different level. Tell me a little bit about what you guys have done over this last year to do that, maybe with your leadership teams that you're leading. Why do you feel that it's so important to have times like that and activities like that where, whether it's a golf outing or sporting clays, but, you know, people kind of getting together and just building relationship.
Well, you know, it's so funny. Like yesterday, we turned everything off. Well, we kind of had to. There's no cell signal where we were at. We were in the mountains, and we didn't want to use our phones or anything. But what's the funniest thing is last night, I felt like I was really behind on everything. Mm-hmm. But by the time I got here to the office this morning, I was mm-hmm. caught up on everything.
Yep.
So nothing, the world didn't change, anything like that. And what was really good about that is I felt like I was refreshed. We were out in the beautiful area out there, just the clean air and everything. And when we had fun, we mm-hmm. become closer than we are even now. But that's the same thing we could do with our entrepreneur partners, right? Mm-hmm. And people love to have fun in general. Mm-hmm. I mean, people are naturally want to have fun.
Right.
We do get hung up in the day-to-day. We can grind and everything like that. But man, it's just a lot of fun. And I love seeing other people have fun too. Mm-hmm. And you know, it's the whole thing is the more people laugh, the healthier it is yeah. for you anyway. And so when you're having some fun, life goes on. You still have to be productive. You still have to take care of your business and that. But you know what? Business, especially most business out there, we're in the business of people. No matter what mm-hmm. business you're in, it's people. So I'm looking forward to a lot of these with a lot of our business partners doing things like that and having fun. But it really makes your community better. So that fire truck I was talking about mm-hmm. looks all clean out there. Mm-hmm. And so is your community of mm-hmm. entrepreneurs.
Jim, one of the things that people mention about you and your wife, Dolores, is that you guys are just incredible relationship builders, right? It's like, it's probably, if I were to try to pick a superpower that you have, or maybe a secret sauce of your entrepreneurial journey, it's your ability to build relationships, right? I mean, it's unbelievable how, regardless of a person's background, their age, their demographic, you have a way of connecting and building relationship. And, you know, that's what we were doing yesterday, right? Business is all about relationships. And so we are out there, whether you're out at a sporting clays, whether you're out on the golf course, whether one of the things that I see that you love to do in Florida is you take people out on your boat and you go deep sea fishing and you go out fishing in the, you know, off the coast. And so Tell me a little bit about how you have leveraged those types of activities in terms of building relationships.
Yeah, so building relations does not come naturally for me, right? Like,
really? I would not have guessed that. I mean, it seems like it's like just par for the course for you.
It's not. I'm honestly more introverted than most people know.
Okay.
Right? If I went someplace and I didn't know anybody, I'd be sitting at the table by myself having a good time. Right? Yeah. Dolores, now she's totally opposite, right? She loves people, loves to be around them. Not that I don't love people, it was uncomfortable for me.
Right.
A book that Dolores and I actually just recently went through was DNA of Relationships by Gary Smalley.
Okay.
You know, so I forget more than I know, so I got to be reminded.
Mm-hmm.
So it is easier to do things with people that, you know, you like to do, right? Like you just said, yeah, well, a couple of times a year we have people come down and they run for a goal. If they hit the goal, they come down to Florida and we go out shark fishing or grouper fishing, or just go, mm-hmm. if they don't like fishing, just go out on a boat for the day. And it's awesome. We usually have a couple national conventions mm-hmm. a year, and we had one last year that was limited in mm-hmm. space and stuff. It wasn't the same. It was good to be around people, right. but I do understand, and it goes back to the book, Speed of Trust, mm-hmm. right? Without the relationship, people don't trust you. And if they don't trust you, they're not going to give it their all.
Mm-hmm.
And if they don't give it their all, they're actually hurting themselves and they don't know it, right? Mm-hmm. It's one of those unconscious, competent things that Dolores says that I do. And I like to get to know people, mm-hmm. you know, and that was uncomfortable for me. But I do like to ask questions and listen. And I think one thing that I do see a lot of people do is they ask a question and then they want to put their input. And it's better to listen twice as much as we speak, right? Mm-hmm. And that can be hard, but nobody likes that, you know, Timmy Topper of the story. Mm-hmm. But you know what? Everybody likes to be heard. And it's amazing that I'm just thinking of some of the people that I've recently met within the last 3 months, and I haven't talked to them a lot,
mm-hmm.
but I've listened to them a lot. They feel they feel loved, mm-hmm. right? This is the word I'm looking for. Mm-hmm. And when they do that, then they're going to listen to what you suggest, right? Because we're all entrepreneurs in our business. Mm-hmm. So it's a volunteer army, right? Like starting your own business, you're starting your own business on your own. And you only make money if you succeed. And our whole job is to help people succeed, right?
Mm-hmm.
In any business, you want your business partners to succeed because it helps the overall business. And without the relationship, without them knowing that if you suggest something, it's actually for their benefit, not yours,
mm-hmm.
then they'll do it. But if some people feel that you're suggesting things for your gain, not theirs, they ain't gonna do it. So there's no trust, no relationship, right. And then the business relationship gets severed. And it's a cycle I see some people in a lot, that why can't I move forward? It's because you're not changing,
mm-hmm.
you know? And I don't know how many books in our library that I have on relationships, but I bet you it's well over 30, 35 books just mm-hmm. on relationships,
wow.
you know, outside of the business, outside of marriage, outside of, you know, right. all that leadership and all that stuff. But I think it's a big deal that people understand that you got to open up. And mm-hmm. that's a big part of, hey, we want to get back out, you know, shaking hands and giving people hugs and telling them that we're with them, right? Mm-hmm. I won't say that it's because we weathered the storm. It's more, you know, like they say, there's no bad weather, just bad clothing.
Oh, I love that.
You know, so when the storm hit in business, mm-hmm. you just got to change your clothing, right? Mm-hmm. You got to change the way you're doing things. And if you have relationships, those people are going to change with you faster. Without the relationships, they don't change. They fade away. And if people fade away, then you're starting over and you're cycling your business.
Mm-hmm.
And this is why, you know, businesses like to hire people that have experience, so they don't have to do as much training.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't like to do as much training either, mm-hmm. right? As, man, I'd love to, I want duplication. I want mm-hmm. that power compounding working for the positive mm-hmm. in our business. And that's why through this whole thing, like last year, you know, COVID and all that stuff, that was, you know, affected the nation. But as you know, I had a herniated disc. I had pinched nerves. I had all kinds of pain that I went mm-hmm. through last year. Most people don't even know it. And I'm good with that. I don't want them to know it. I mean, they might be going, oh, you're saying it now. Well, I'm done with it, right? Mm-hmm. I had back surgery in November, and I woke up, I've healed, right? Mm-hmm. Like, literally, my doctor told me, he's like, it's going to take 6-8 weeks for that nerve to calm down. Mm-hmm. Instantly, when I woke up, it was gone. I knew wow. the surgery worked.
Wow.
So, you know, it's... I don't know. It's like being a duck on water, right? Mm-hmm. Everything looks good on the surface, but inside you're grinding.
Right.
And I love the grind also, but I also love, hey, that we could take time like yesterday, go shooting, have some fun. I found out the world didn't fall apart when Jim Martin wasn't working.
That's right. You know, a second ago you mentioned about when as you're building relationships in business, it's key that people are realizing that you're building relationships and you're helping folks, and it's for their benefit first before it's for your benefit. And when you have things in the proper order, how it can make such a huge difference, right? And it strikes me that I think we've all had those experiences where we've been in business, where we've walked into a business where we didn't feel like our interests were number one, but like there was a sales guy that was trying to, you know, push his agenda, his or her agenda, you know, on us. And probably the one that we've all had has been, you know, that whether, you know, car shopping or the used car salesman, right? And I've had some experiences where I've literally walked out of a showroom and be like, this guy does not care at all about me. He's just wanting to, you know, hit his end of month quota. I literally had a guy here in Knoxville a couple years ago. I was car shopping and I had just gone into a showroom looking at a vehicle. He called me back and he never mentioned anything about the things that I was looking for in a vehicle, what I wanted. He was like, hey, the end of month is tonight at, you know, midnight. And he literally said this, I've got to hit my quota. And if you like that, you know, particular vehicle, I've got it here. Can you come in? Do you think you can come in before close of business? And I'm thinking to myself, you've got to be the worst salesman in the entire world. You're talking about you. You're talking about what you need. You're not once are you talking about, well, hey, did you like this particular vehicle? How can I help you? It was just about me. I was like, number one, I'll never buy a vehicle from you. And I'm also not going back to that dealership, because it signaled to me that dealership had not done a good job of teaching and training. It's like, I don't want anything to do with that type of culture. So in life, you mean, so you highlighted this about how important it is for people to understand that you are for them, that you are seeking to serve them, that you're seeking to help them. And this is what you and Dolores do so very well, that you're putting their needs, their goals first. And you guys intuitively know that as you serve more people, as you help more people, that you yourself will be able to hit your goals and so forth. Help me contextualize, you know, practical application for people who are out there, maybe, you know, new entrepreneurs and needing to understand this very, very important piece, because I think this is one of the things that you are absolutely world class at.
Yeah. Well, thanks. It is sincerely wanting to get to know them. Right, because it can be surface, mm-hmm. right? Like, you know, we've all heard the come early, stay late. Well, I've seen people come exactly on time and be the first to leave. Mm-hmm. And that just says that it's all about me. My time's more precious than yours. Mm-hmm. So I learned this acronym a long time ago, right, when I was probably from one of the books that I've read. It's called FORM, right? And it stands for Family, Occupation, Recreation, and Motivation. So I ask questions to people. Family, occupation, recreation, and motivation. So I'll say, you know, if I was just getting to know you, Bob, I would say, you know, are you married? Yeah, I've been married 13 years. Oh, do you have any kids? Yeah, I got kids. How many? What's their ages? You know, do they play sports? And those few questions just about family might mean 15 minutes of just mm-hmm. listening, mm-hmm. you know, because people love to talk about things that are important to them. Mm-hmm. So what do you do for a living, Bob? Oh, I'm CEO of, you know, blah, blah, blah. You know, so, and where do you see that taking in the next 5-10 years? So it what it's doing for me is twofold. I'm getting to know the person, mm-hmm. but I'm also building a case of how I'm going to relate our business on how it can fit into their lives. Mm-hmm. You know, and because what we do, everybody already does, mm-hmm. you know. So I want them to see not only the simplicity of it, but how it could benefit them, mm-hmm. you know? So recreation, what do you and your family like to do for fun? Oh, we like to travel. We like to camp. Oh, where do you like to go camping? Well, you know, Higgin Lake State Park. You know, what do you do up there? All of that is sincere.
Yeah.
I've met tens of thousands of people in the last, 20 years. So I'm knowledgeable on stuff that I never would have been knowledgeable about. Mm. So then I can actually ask right questions about what they do, right? So it's all about relating to them, because if you can't relate to people, mm-hmm. you don't build a relationship. If you don't build a relationship, there's no trust, then your business is gone. This right here is probably the number one biggest thing that I see people fail at miserably. Because, well, I hear comments like, well, I don't be people's babysitter. I don't want to, I don't need any more friends. Okay, well, then keep your job. Yeah. And don't ask for any help, right? Like, you have to, and people's lives can get messy, right? Mm-hmm. Right? Like, we are problem solvers as entrepreneurs and not problems push-awayers, mm-hmm. right? Because if there's a problem in somebody's life, well, don't talk to me about that. Mm-hmm. Well, then you're not truly my friend,
mm-hmm.
you know? And if you're not truly my friend, I don't trust you anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all about you, you know? So I think just asking those questions. And I recently heard this, Cody Newton had an audio come out and he talks about, hey, what motivates you?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's the last one, motivation, because people's motivation, the first three things are very important to them, right? Their family, their occupation, how what they have fun doing, recreation, but there's something that motivates them to do that, right? And whatever that is going to be their reason for getting into business. Owning your own business, right? I think the American dream is not to have a safe, secure job, because there is no such thing as a safe, secure job, right? There is what's safe.
Most, if I could just interject there, if most employees in America realized how insecure their job really was, the conversations that go on in a boardroom behind the scenes with, where they're like, hey, should we shut this plant down? Should we move this plant to Mexico? Should we move this to Canada? You know, how many people should we lay off? If they really understood how insecure their jobs really were, people would be terrified. You had iconic companies that have been around for 100 years that went out of business this last year, where people were like, there's no way this company is going to go under. But you are absolutely spot on.
Well, me being from Detroit, right, originally, mm-hmm. I'm trying to think of the time frame. Like, let's just say the 2004, 2008, mm-hmm. GM, mm-hmm. Chrysler, they were moving their plants out of the country, right? Yep. In the last 4 years, they were bringing jobs back. I seen a news flash come across my phone last week that GM's looking to invest $1 billion in Mexico to move a facility down there. Wow. So, yeah. So how many jobs is that that'll be lost, right? Mm-hmm. Like, I remember you talking not long ago about cashiers. There's technology out there that's going to replace the 3.5 million cashiers across our country.
Yep.
So what are those 3.5 million people going to do, right? They need to own something.
Yep.
and that something is some kind of business that is going to be inflation-proof, that you can do, that can have, hey, where do I want, long-term mm-hmm. vision, where do I want to be? Delay of gratification. You've got to learn some stuff. Mm-hmm. So you can have that power of compounding going for you. But anyways, that was a long-winded answer to your question. But those things, getting to know people, that's where you start to build a bond. And, you know, when I see people after I met them the first time, I remember their names.
Mm-hmm.
That's very important, because then people, oh, man, this guy.
This guy knows my name.
Yeah, he knows my name. And I ask them about their kids.
Right.
Like, what is, you know, he's asking about my kids, you know, how's the job going? It's not, what can you do for me? How's your business going? You know, I think that is one thing that, and people, man, I'm thinking of names of people down in Florida that I'm very close with, that they deal with people all day at their mm-hmm. job. So they want to shut it off at night. Well, if you shut it off at night, you're going to be dealing with people all day at your job for the rest of your life.
Mm-hmm.
So it, you know, Dolores and my life.
That is so spot on.
Dolores and my life, we got unbalanced for about 18 months. That was it. Mm-hmm. That was 18 years ago. Mm-hmm. Then we've been full-time entrepreneurs since then. You know, did we miss some things? Yes. But did we gain a millionfold? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Right? The time that we've traveled with our kids, right? So we homeschooled our two youngest kids, and we'd be able to. So what motivates me is, I love trips, mm-hmm. right? So we would literally, there was times that we got in the car, our kids studied the Civil War. Mm-hmm. that summer, we got in the car, went to, actually, no, we went the beginning of fall. So we ended up in Gettysburg on Labor Day when everybody was leaving. Mm-hmm. We were just getting there to start our 2 weeks to go travel all the battlefields of the Civil War.
That's awesome.
Right? A year after that, we went out, Madison learned all about cliff-dwelling Indians in Colorado. So we went to Cortez, Colorado. Walked all the cliff dwellings, learned all about that, spent 10 days out in Colorado. It's one of the best trips that we still talk about. Mm-hmm. You know, our car, it was in August, and our car air conditioner broke down.
Oh, no.
Right? So here we are in this hot H2 Hummer, all the windows down, driving, you know, 1,600 miles.
Oh, my gosh.
But it was still one of the best times, right? Yeah. So the motivation of all that... that's what's going to have you push past all those trying times, the problems that's going to arise, the discomfort in your life. You're going to have it anyways.
Right.
You might as well own it when it happens to you instead of letting somebody else bring that discomfort into your life.
Right. Such words of wisdom there. And, you know, for people who are listening, going back to what started this thread in the conversation was talking about building relationships and understanding people. And no matter what type of business that you're in, if you follow this form in asking questions, building relationship, family, occupation, recreation, motivation, this is the basic building block for any business, right? And I'm thinking in my mind of local establishments or businesses that I like to support where I know people that are there. And it's like I walk in the front door and they know who I am. And they take an extra time to like ask me questions. How can I serve you? How can I help you? What's going on? It's like, I love going to places like that, right? Where I feel like my needs are being met and there's like a real connection, a real relationship. So for entrepreneurs that are listening, regardless of what business that you're in, what Jim just shared is a basic tenet and building block for success. Joe, as you've been listening here, you know, add some of your insights on some of the things that we've been talking about over the last couple minutes.
Well, you know, it's funny. Jim said at the beginning here, he said that he forgets more than he learns. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm sitting here with a pad of paper with notes like that. I'm looking in front of him. He's doing all this from his mind.
Yeah.
Right?
I'm sitting here writing notes as well.
I know, you and I both, yeah. Know, I'm looking at him. He's
just regurgitating.
Crazy to me. I'm going, this is crazy. This form, I know he's taught this before, but I just wrote it down too and reminded me. And I've heard him even say this, right? Mm-hmm. But he is unbelievable at that and asking questions. I've seen him do it. I see him do it with me. That's why he builds that trust and everything. So it was just hilarious that as this stuff is regurgitated out from you, how good you really are with people. And that's why you have the businesses that you have. But going back to, you know, having all the fun, people want to be around people, Bob. Mm-hmm. People want to be successful. Naturally, they want that. And no matter what you do in life, being an entrepreneur gives you all of that. Mm-hmm. You just have to be hungry enough. You have to be energetic enough. You have to want something bad enough to be able to go get it. So if it's freedom, like I make jokes all the time that I'm getting older now, you know, and I just turned 56 years old, and maybe most of my life might be behind me. And as we get closer to the end of life on earth here, that things are more special now. Mm-hmm. And you know what? How many people are thinking that same exact thing right now? Mm-hmm. And so as these podcasts, as people are learning from this podcast and other information, that is so pivotal to someone's success, and there's just their well-being anyway here. You know, so I applaud you for putting this podcast together, the success you're having with it, Bob. Seriously, the information, I love it. I think it's very, I think people, if they tune in and get this and utilize it in their own life, it could be a blessing. Just like what Jim's talking about here with all this, with form and the three successes of, I mean, that's gold. And you learn more from people like that for sure.
Well, thank you for those kind words. And as I've really enjoyed, it's easy for me. I just set up the studio, get a couple microphones out, and get smart and accomplished individuals like you. Your wives have both been on the program in the past, and so I just get to ask questions and then write notes and listen. I get to live and learn from your all's life experiences, so it's quite a blessing for me to be able to do this and get a front row seat with a bunch of incredible individuals. Speaking of entrepreneurship, you said something just a second ago, and you said, oh, it was, you know, people want to be successful. People want to scale up and, you know, have success in life. And I think that that was, has been a part of the American dream, right? It's part of the American DNA. And I saw some research recently that stated that social mobility and income mobility has been a very big part of the American dream, meaning where you are born, almost every generation in America, tracking all the way back to the founding of our country, each generation did better than their parents. And that this is the first generation in American history where this generation is expected to do worse than their parents. It's like the American dream is going in reverse. And what I've shared with my children is I said, guys, if you want to have a successful life, if you want to, what are your hopes? What are your dreams, right? So Jim, you know, the last one on form, I'm asking my kids, what's your motivation? What do you guys want to accomplish? I want to figure out as a dad, how can I help my children? And one of the things I've shared with them, I was like, guys, you're not going to be able to, air quotes here, employ your way to getting those things, right? Becoming, and nothing wrong with being an employee, working for a great company, but if you're wanting to radically change the course of your life, a lot of times, I believe, especially in this new generation, it is going to require not just having one job, but it's going to require having multiple jobs. It's going to require having being in the gig economy, having a side gig, being an entrepreneur. And so what would you share with people who, you know, if we're now living in that type of environment where entrepreneurship is going to be absolutely critical for people to have the American dream and to scale up and do well, what would be, you know, you being an entrepreneur for many, many years, having been involved in many various businesses, are there any insights, any keys? I mean, we've been talking a lot today about little tips, we'll call them maybe entrepreneur hacks, but what are things that you would share with people to help them either start the journey or have success on that journey?
That's a great question, Bob. And I have two adult children myself, and I always tell them, I said, the people you hang around with depends on your success. So look at the people you're hanging around with, look at the people you're associating with. Those are, that if that's what you want to, your income level will be in that that range or whatever it is 5 years from now, then that's fine. But if you have people around you that are successful, you'll become naturally successful. So I truly think it's get away from all the negative that's out there. Mm-hmm. Get away from all the negative Nancys that are out there. Mm-hmm. Have positive in your life. Be around people that truly want you to win, and you'll know that. Mm-hmm. Some people say, well, how do I know if they truly? You'll know. You'll feel it.
You can feel authenticity, can't you?
You sure can. You can't fake it. So I tell my adult kids all the time, and they're both thriving in their careers, and they're both entrepreneurs also. But it's because they're starting to realize that when you're hanging around people have this like-minded success as you do, you'll all succeed together.
Mm-hmm. That's a great one.
Yeah, so the number one problem people don't succeed, I believe, is they accept their own excuses. And there's a great book, Magic of Thinking Big, right? It's an old book, but chapter two in that book is titled Excuse-itis. And if you are striving to be an entrepreneur, the number one thing you have to do is stop accepting your excuses, right? To get everything you want in that forum, family, occupation, recreation, motivation, you can't accept excuses, right? I've always been a non-excuse kind of guy. And I think it's because my parents gave me tough love and made me earn everything. So you have to figure out ways. A lot of times when I'm talking business with people, they tell me things like, well, I'm afraid of success or I'm this, I'm that. Okay, well, stop it. Right? Like, I know it's not that easy, but you're accepting your own excuses. And excuses will keep you where you're at. That's not even true. Excuses will make you horror in not only money, but in time and relationships, it's going to, your excuses are going to damage you long term, right? And that's part of the power of compounding. So if anything, anybody out there striving to be an entrepreneur is, if you come up with an excuse, find a way to squash it, find a way to get around it, fix it, not, you know, not, don't buy into it. I could have bought into an excuse. I didn't like to talk to people. Mm-hmm. I didn't like to meet new people.
I'm an introvert.
Right, right. Totally. You know, and I like to tell people what to do. Well, in my line of work, I can't tell people what to do. I have to be extroverted. I have to put a smile on my face, even when I'm hurting, right? So, you know, it's, I couldn't accept my excuses if I wanted to win.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I'm too old, I'm too young, I'm too this, I'm too that, I'm not educated. Well, let me tell you, I have a high school education. I copied and cheated all the way through high school. I'm not proud of that, but I hated schoolwork because I didn't feel it was going to help me get what I wanted.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
you weren't connecting the dots how this was going to help you accomplish your hopes and dreams and so forth.
Right.
Yeah. What's the point?
Why am I taking this earth science class? Cause I had to, I'm not going to do anything with earth science. Right.
Mm-hmm.
I knew I wasn't going to do anything with, math. Why'd I have to learn geometry, all that stuff. And I learned it, but you know what? I forgot it too.
Right.
But don't take this the wrong way, but I haven't had a job in 18 years, right? Almost 18 years. And that's because I think that you said it earlier, the number one thing to success is relationships.
Mm-hmm.
It's not, I think you should be educated, but educated in the stuff that's going to help you. Don't learn a bunch of stuff that you're never going to use, mm-hmm. right? It's just going to cloud you or it's going to slow you down, right? So, but I think the number one thing for an entrepreneur, especially a striving entrepreneur, or just want to be, don't accept your own excuses. Right. There's always going to be a problem. You have to figure out how to fix it.
Well, you know, one of the things that I've learned in my career is that as I look back, I'm a world class storyteller to myself. Right. Like if we can create these narratives, I call it, you know, a narrative or a story about, well, the reason this is happening is because of this. And I will create this great narrative. And then what I've needed is for someone to, like a coach, a mentor, a friend, and say, Bob, you know that story that you're telling yourself? You know that narrative that you've created? Actually, that's an excuse that you've bought into, and it's a false narrative. That's not real. You're just, you've created that and you're believing that because psychologically that's creating a safety net for you. But what you need to do is that is a false narrative. And I've had some really close friends and a good mentor, a good coach that have called me on it and said, no, strike that. I'm like, oh, and so your point here is spot on. And you know, all of us, I believe, can be world-class excuse makers, narrative and storytellers, and sometimes we need a friend. Sometimes we need a coach or a mentor to kind of like poke the balloon a little bit and pop it and say, no, that's a false narrative. That's right. And so for people who are listening, if you what Jim has just shared is absolutely spot on. Don't allow excuses to derail your hopes and dreams and what you want to accomplish in life. And sometimes you need a friend to speak truth to you, to share truth and say, you know what? I know you think that, you know, this is limiting. I know you think that you're not going to be able to have success because of X, Y, and Z. You know, you weren't born in the right family. You don't have the right resources. You don't have this. You don't have that. Oh, my goodness, we've had COVID, right? There's a million excuses that we can create. And sometimes it just takes a close friend, someone that you trust, someone that you have a relationship with to say, no, that don't buy into that.
Well, you just hit it. If you don't have a relationship with that person, mm-hmm. you can't tell them that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's where it all starts.
Well, we've come full circle. We started talking about relationships. We've talked a whole lot this afternoon and come all the way coming back to relationships once again. Relationships is the key to business. I think relationships is the key to life as well. Right. Like I think about the things that I enjoy doing. Think about our milestones, the things when we want to celebrate, like a birthday, a milestone, something monumental in life, something fun if we've had a success. If you're all by yourself, alone in a room, it's like that's not fun. I want to. What do you want to do? You want to enjoy those moments with friends, with family, with relationships. Jim, you have highlighted multiple books today. I've written them down. First and foremost, you highlighted DNA of Relationships by Smalley. You highlighted Speed of Trust by Covey. You've talked about Magic of Thinking Big. Remind me of the author.
David Schwartz.
Joe, you have any books that off the top of your head that you'd like to highlight?
Yeah, right. I mean, we've read a lot of books over the years, yeah. And I'm like Jim, well, what he says anyway, that I have to keep on rereading them. I reread a lot of books. Right now, I'm finishing up How to Fail in Almost Everything and Still Win Big by Scott Adams.
How to Fail in Almost Everything and Still Win Big.
Yeah, and I was suggested by one of my business associates about it. It's an excellent book. I'm finishing that up right now, but what I'm studying is Radical Candor by Kim Scott.
Nice.
And so, you know, I think as we read through books, I just think it's important to study them. And sometimes I'll listen to them on the audio, but I also study them by reading them and highlighting everything. So I have to keep that in front of me an hour a day myself, because mm-hmm. it's too easy to get busy on something else. Right. But you just got to keep, I know one thing, as we get older, if we can keep our brains and our thoughts in tune, mm-hmm. the rest of our body might diminish a little bit.
Right.
Well, not yet.
Not you guys. That's
right. But our mind, if we can keep our mind sharp, we're going to last a long time.
Yeah.
So those are two things I'm reading and studying right now.
Fantastic. Well, I'll make sure that those are in the show notes. And so guys, I almost want to say thank you. You know, it's been enjoyable not only having some fun with you guys over the last couple of days and going down to Garland Mountain doing some sporting clays, but also just being able to hang out, learn from you, been able to ask questions as we've been driving down and driving back. And, you know, we cooked out last night and then having some time in the office today. You guys are both world-class at building relationships with people. You're both world-class entrepreneurs. And I would just say, as a friend, you guys are also world-class friends. So I just want to say thank you. It's been enjoyable having you on the program and look forward to having you guys back.
Thanks, Bob.
Yeah, thanks, Bob. It's a lot of fun hanging around with you yourself. You're world-class in all your areas of your life, man. Appreciate you.
All right. Well, hey, thank you so much. Today's episode was engineered and produced by Jeremy Going. A special thanks to our very special guests, Joe Darkangelo and Jim Martin. Make sure that you subscribe to this podcast on Apple Podcasts, or if you're an Android user, check us out over on Spotify. And if you liked the show, please recommend it to a friend and give us a review. That's always extremely helpful. Thanks for listening to Taking the Leap Podcast. We'll be back later with more interviews of leaders, business owners, shakers and movers, and people taking leaps and doing very interesting things in life and business. And finally, as we close, a very special shout out to all the Bonvera entrepreneurs around the country who are preparing and game planning for the October National Training Event in Independence, Missouri. I'm super excited to see you there. We're planning on a whole host of special guest speakers and special rollouts and things that we're going to be doing there. So it's very exciting. Looking forward to seeing you guys in person, and we will see you very soon. Take care and God bless.